Yeah, thank you very much. Thanks, Nicolas, thanks, David, and thanks all the organizers for the invitation. And I need to apologize since I have to leave today for I cannot stay more, unfortunately, so I'm sorry about this, but I enjoyed very much this conference. So I'm gonna report on some recent results I got on Quiver Grassmannians of Dynkin type, but I would like to give you also an introduction to the subject. So Quiver Grassmannians are projective varieties attached to quiver representations, and somehow the hope is that their geometry can be studied using techniques of quiver representations. So that's the idea. So this quiver. So that's the title of my talk. So let Q be Dynkin quiver with set of vertices say Q naught 1n. So Q is an orientation of a simply laced Dynkin diagram of type AD. So Q is an orientation of a simply laced Dynkin diagram of type ADE. And actually, it is allowed to consider Q as a disjoint union of such diagrams, but this doesn't play any role. So let D, a dimension vector. So this is a tuple of non-negative integers attached to vertices of Q. The vector space Rd Q direct sum hom Cdi Cdj parametrizes representation of Q of dimension vector D. Okay, and the group GT acts on RDQ by base change, and since Q is Dynkin, there are only finitely many orbits. So in particular, there is one orbit which is dense. Okay. And I denote a point of this orbit by MD tilde. Okay. As already mentioned in some talks, there is a degeneration order. So we say that two orbits, so if GDM1 closure contains the orbits of another point, then we say we write M1, M2, and then this is definition of the degeneration order, and then it's a theorem. Type A by Abbeasis Delfra, and then Bongaerts. Well, in this case of Dynkin quivers, I mean, it's, let's say Bongaerts is the right reference. So the dimension on Q. XM1, the dimension of OMQ, XM2, for all X indecomposable. Okay, so I'm gonna sometimes use the short note, which is XM2 with this bracket. Okay. And M tilde D is characterized by the homological condition X1 0. And a representation having this property is called rigid. So for Dynkin quivers, generic representations are precisely the rigid one. So yeah, so generic means that they have a, you know, dense orbit. Okay, so now let's go to the topic of this lecture. So fix another dimension vector such that D minus E is again a dimension vector. And then consider the following kind of universal object called the universal Quiver Grassmannian. Define GEQD as the incidence variety. So we take a tuple of vector subspaces indexed by the vertices of Q, and then a tuple of linear maps. So this belongs to product of gr ei cdi times rdq, and then the incidence condition is the obvious one. F alpha ui is contained in uj for every arrow of q. And this is called the universal Quiver Grassmannian. So the universal Quiver Grassmannian is the universal object parameterizing Quiver Grassmannians, because Quiver Grassmannians naturally comes in families, and this incidence variety is the universal variety parameterizing these families. So we have two. Yes, of course you can interrupt me anytime you want. I forgot to tell you, but. So we have the two projection. And is a nice observation of Schofield. That P1 is a vector bundle of rank, well, some, yeah, so, well. Dij minus EIDJ. So as a consequence, we see that the universal Quiver Grassmannian is actually smooth and irreducible. And we can also compute the dimension. So corollary. EQD is irreducible and smooth of dimension of this dimension, so that's dimension of EQD, where this notation stands for the Euler-Ringel form of the quiver. Okay, so that's very good. But what is also very good is that P2 is a proper map, because of course we are projecting along a projective variety, which is, you know, the product of Grassmannian. So P2 is a proper map. And definition. The quiver EM P2 inverse of M is called a quiver Grassmannian. Of M. Okay, so that's the definition of quiver Grassmannians. As a set, this is nothing but the set of subrepresentations of M of dimension vector E. And of course, this set can be empty. It's not true that, you know, every representation admits a subrepresentation for any dimension, of course. And so it is interesting to say, what is the image of P2? So image of P2 is closed in RD Q. It consists of all representation of dimension vector D admitting a subrepresentation of dimension vector E. And there is a very nice result by Reineke Kerkman, and where they characterize the image as follows. So I want to mention this. So it's, I think, 2015. So M belongs to the image of P2 if and only if the dimension of Om Q X M is dimension of X E for all X indecomposable. So since we are in the Dynkin case, this is a finite number of inequalities. So in principle, I mean, can be checked. I mean, those provides finitely many conditions to check that a given representation is in the image of P2. And I have to tell you that this is a non-trivial result. I mean, it uses a lot of kind of tricks. And it's recent, but there is a okay. All right, so it's 9:15. So you see, for every representation in the image of P2, we have attached a projective variety. And it is interesting to see what kind of projective varieties arises and what can we say about their geometry. And in order to do geometry, we need a formula for the tangent space at a given point. And this formula is the formula that you expect, you know, for Grassmannian of subspaces. The tangent space at a given subspace is given by the homomorphism from the subspace to the quotient. And the same holds here in the context of quivers. So, tangent space formula. This was proved by Schofield first in the 90s. And then there is an independent proof by Caldero and Reineke much later. And the tangent space pop formula is the following. Let M a point in the image of P2. So of course, the image of P2 always contains the zero representation, and the fiber is just the product of Grassmannian. So P2 is a proper map, so the image cannot be empty. So let M in the image of P2, and let N a point in the fiber. Then there is an isomorphism of vector spaces. The tangent space at this point N at this Grassmannian is isomorphic to the vector space of Q homomorphisms between N and the quotient. Okay, I have to say something, I mean, trivial, but of course, here the notation is bad because I should have said that we are quotient M by the given embedding of N into M. So of course, when I say that N is a point of the Grassmannian, I'm choosing this embedding. Okay, so. Okay, but that's very nice because you see, this formula allows us to study the geometry of these varieties. For example, this is if a point is singular or not, only looking at homological, properties. And as a consequence, one immediately gets the following corollary. If M tilde D is in the image of P2, then Gr E M tilde D is smooth. And proof, take a point then the dimension of om q of you see x1 q n m over n the dimension of x1 m tilde d which is zero. Here I'm using the fact that the algebra is hereditary, the path algebra of the quiver. And so dimension of om n m over n is equal to e d minus e. And here I'm using the well-known fact that x, y, well, I'm using the homological interpretation of the Euler form. I mean, that's, you can trust. It's a well-known fact. So we have, yes.
So M is the M tilde
D? Yes, thank you very much. Yes. So, Quiver Grassmannian associated with rigid representations are smooth. Okay, so let's see when it happens that M tilde D admits a subrepresentation of dimension vector E. So we have the following proposition. And here I have to cite Schofield. Well, you find also a proof in my papers with Reineke Feigin, but actually, also in my last paper. I didn't mention that I'm going to present some results which are contained in a paper that I put on archive some months ago. And it's going to appear in the Springer volume for the DFG priority program, I mean, the 1388. So you find all the details on archive. Just look for my last paper. Okay, so the proposition says M tilde D belongs to the image of P2 if and only if x1 M tilde D minus E is zero. So again, an homological condition. In this case, Gr E M tilde D is smooth. Well, I already mentioned the smoothness, but one can prove more that this variety is irreducible of dimension the Euler form. And that's really good news for the reason I'm gonna tell you. Okay. This number, or the form of E with D minus E, has a very, very special and clear geometric meaning. It's the smallest dimension of any irreducible component of any Quiver Grassmannian associated with a representation in the image of P2. So from the definition, it follows that every irreducible component I of EM for some M in the image of P2satisfies dimension of I ED minus E. Why? Well, this is because this number is precisely the difference of the dimension of the universal object, which is the total space of my proper map, with the base variety. So it's a kind of well-known fact from algebraic geometry. So, definition, we say that a Quiver Grassmannian has minimal dimension if it is equidimensional, so of dimension E D minus E. Okay, good. All right, so we see that Quiver Grassmannians, non-empty Quiver Grassmannians associated with rigid representations are smooth of minimal dimension. And now, the question is, are there other smooth Quiver Grassmannians of minimal dimension? And the result I'm gonna tell you is says that no. I mean, actually there are others, but the topological structure is the same. So let's introduce the following set. In the image of P2, such that EM is smooth of minimal dimension. Then a little lemma that you find in my paper is SED is non-empty if and only if the generic representation belong to here, to him, to it. Okay, so that's a first observation. So in case the generic representation does not admit a subrepresentation of dimension vector E, then all Quiver Grassmannians either they have higher dimension or the generic Quiver Grassmannian would have higher dimension somehow. Okay, that's correct. Okay, so other questions so far? Please feel free to ask. Okay, and now comes my first theorem, which is actually turns out to be just an easy observation from algebraic geometry, but it took me some time to realize. So recall two projective varieties x1 and x2 are called deformation equivalent if they are part of a smooth family over a connected base space. So if there exists a smooth map, P from X to Y connected, connected, and two points in Y such that P inverse of P1 is X1, P inverse of P2 is X2. And deformation equivalent varieties share many geometric properties. It is an observation of Eresmann that in differential geometry that two deformation equivalent varieties are diffeomorphic. So this means that topologically they are the same space. So they share all the topological invariants, but the complex structure changes, right? So remark x1, x2 deformation equivalent implies x1, x2 diffeomorphism, morphic. So in particular, they share the same topological invariants. For example, Poincaré polynomial and then Euler characteristic. So they have the same Poincaré polynomial, like they have the same Betti numbers. But the opposite is not true. It's quite famous that there are examples in all dimensions that there are diffeomorphic varieties which are not deformation equivalent. And having deformation equivalent varieties, it's much is stronger. For example, they share the same Hodge numbers. Yes. And the theorem is that given M1 and M2 in SED, so given two representations whose Quiver Grassmannians are smooth of minimal dimension, the corresponding Quiver Grassmannians are deformation equivalent. Yes. Okay. Okay, so we see that the fibers over SED topologically are all the same, but the complex structure changes. So, okay, so and the proof of this theorem is kind of trivial. Actually, I prepared the proof for you, but I'm a bit too late, so I will postpone. It's just three lines. It was a bit disappointing, but I mean, it's just an observation, but what is important for me are the applications. So, and the first application, which was actually my starting point, is the Caldero Chapoton formula. So the story here is the following. Caldero and Chapoton in 2006 put the first brick for the explicit description of the cluster variables associated with a skew-symmetric matrix. So they provide an explicit formula for them, and I'm going to tell you what is this. So definition, F polynomials, so given M, define Fm y1, yn, so as the generating function of the Euler characteristic of Quiver Grassmannians associated with M. So, and this of course means y1 to e1, y2 to e2, yn to en. So that's the F polynomial of a Q representation. Then the second ingredient is the G vector, or index. So given M, again, it's G vector, then we take an injective resolution. Minimal injective resolution, actually this doesn't matter, of M. Then the G vector of M is defined as the class of I0 M minus the class of I1 M in the Grothendieck group of Q, which is identified with Z to the N. So it's an integer vector. Actually, there is a more explicit formula for this, but anyway, it's just something that you can easily compute. for any m. And the third ingredient is the exchange matrix associated with the quiver. Ah, no, okay, this should be here, and this should go here. So the exchange matrix, so the terminology of F polynomials and G vector comes from the theory of cluster algebras by Fomin and Zulevinsky. And also the terminology of exchange matrix comes from them. I'm not going to explain what a cluster algebra is, because for this talk it's not really important. But so the third ingredient is the exchange matrix. So this is a matrix, B, BQ, with integer entries of size n, so the number of vertices of Q, and actually the entries are parameterized, are indexed by the vertices of the quiver, and defined by Bij is the number of arrows from J to I minus the number of arrows from I to J. All right, and then using this, they define what is now called the CC formula, and CC stands for Caldero Chapoton, but also for cluster character. And so CC of M, so this depends on N X variables, not to be confused with the Y variables, and is explicitly some E chi of grö e m x b e plus g m, which is the same as saying take the f polynomial of m, evaluate it on the columns somehow of the matrix b, and multiply by the monomial obtained with the G vector. So it's a nice Laurent polynomial. And the theorem of CC is that the set CCM M indecomposable union x1, xn is precisely the set of the coefficient free actually this coefficient oh, okay cluster algebra. AQ, which is the cluster algebra with initial seed BX. Okay, so actually, working with coefficients or without coefficients for our purpose is not really important, since we have a description of the F polynomial, so it's not. So and in 2006, this was really important. Because now, having a kind of explicit description of the cluster variables could provide new instance. One can prove something, no, with this. And actually, it was done. And what is the key step? The proof is not. Thank you very much. Yes. Yes, of cluster variables, so of the generators. The key lemma from which this follows is the following. So key lemma to prove this. So recall that a short exact sequence is called almost split if, first of all, okay. So if, first of all, L, so it's not split. Second, L, the extremal modules are indecomposable. And third, for every map, say S, from X to N, which is not a split epimorphism, there exists T from X to M such that S is equal to pi T, where pi is the projection and I is the injection. Okay. And of course, almost split sequences are famous sequences in the representation theory of algebras, finite-dimensional algebras, found by Auslander and Wright, and they prove that for any indecomposable non-projective, there exists n, there exists such an almost split sequence, and this is unique. I mean, unique in a strong sense, so that, at least for Dynkin quivers, that if you have an exact sequence and you know that there exists with terms L, M, and N, and you know that there exists an almost split sequence with this term, then it must be that. So it's a kind of rigid notion. So for every indecomposable, there exists such an almost split sequence. And the key lemma of Caldero and Chapoton is the following. So for any M indecomposable non-projective, there exists unique almost split sequence which is of the following form. So this term is called tau of M, and this tau is, well, it's called Auslander Wright and Translate, as a well-known. I mean, one can describe explicitly what is this module. And in the Dynkin case also, there are techniques to describe this central module as well. So recall that M is indecomposable and tau M is indecomposable, but E is not. In the Dynkin case, it has at most three indecomposable direct summons. Okay, so the key lemma of Caldero and Chapoton is that the Euler characteristic of grö e m plus tau m is equal to the Euler characteristic of grö e e for any e different from the dimension of m. Yeah, this exclusion is quite clear because if you embed m into m plus tau m, then you cannot embed it into e somehow. Well, actually, okay, so that's the key lemma. And they proved this lemma, so they're working with Euler characteristic. And usually in this topic, what people do is they cut the two varieties into pieces, which are horrible pieces, and they compare them, their Euler characteristic, piece by piece. But you see, this is a beautiful, smooth, irreducible projective variety. So I was always bothered to, you know, cut it into horrible pieces. That's I never. Well, I mean, this equality. Made me wonder, is there a better relation between these two varieties? And as you probably have already guessed, the theorem 2 is that gr e m plus tau m and gr e are deformation equivalent. For every e different from the dimension of m. If e equals to the dimension of m, then this variety is empty, and this variety is just a point. It's very easy to prove. And the proof of theorem 2 is proof. It's, well, first of all, for every one shows that for every n in gr e m plus tau m, x to 1 n m plus tau m n is 0. And that's, and this is very easy to prove, just using the almost split sequence. Indeed, and two, E is rigid. But this is well known. So this fact follows from 1, 2, and 3. It's immediate. I mean, it's just, I don't know, 5, 6 lines. But it provides a much better information than this one. For example, yeah, I will tell you application of this theorem in a minute. But before doing that, a remark is necessary. So first of all, in type A, they are isomorphic. Not diffeomorphic, but isomorphic. So they are really the same projective variety up to isomorphism. And this is very special of type A. In type D and D, this is not the case, and I'm going to show you an example. Okay, so this goes here. So this, the proof that in type A they are isomorphic follows from the explicit description of the almost split sequences given by Butler and Ringel, since those algebras are string algebras. I mean, in type A, those varieties are not really kind of, well, are easy to handle. But in type D, and hence in type E, the situation is more complicated. but so two in type D and E, they are only diffeomorphic in general. There is an example where I will show you, but where GRE is P2 blown up in three distinct P2 blown up in three generic points, while GRE M plus tau M is P2 blow up in three collinear points. And this is the situation that you have to have in mind. So you see P2 blown up in three points, so it's just topological space. But the complex structure differs very much. Those two varieties are not isomorphic. OK, so I want to give you the last application of theorem 2. So this is theorem 3. Suppose SED is non-empty, and let M be one of its points. Then A GREM has no odd cohomology, in particular the Euler characteristic is positive. Is non-negative. B, there is no odd homology. And C, the even homology is torsion-free. Okay. Okay, let me comment. So you see, in principle, there could be torsion here in the homology, but there is no torsion. Yeah, there is no cohomology. Yeah, there's no odd cohomology, but this is homology. So there is no torsion, and okay, so. So I have to say that since GREM is topologically the same space as the Quiver Grassmannian associated with a rigid one, this part A could be deduced by result of Caldero Keller and Nakajima, and there are many others. I mean, proof of the positivity of those varieties. But my proof of theorem 3 is by induction using the theorem 2. Since they are diffeomorphic by induction on the Auslander light and quiver, I could somehow keep track of the Betti numbers. I mean, using some kind of well-known tricks. I mean, the techniques I use is just Bialynitsky-Birola theorem, nothing more. So it's just so I find this proof kind of more concrete than the previous ones. But maybe that depends on the taste, of course. Okay, so I think my time is over, so thank you very much for your attention.
So, are there questions, comments? Are there other cases when you know that the quiver Grassmannians are equidimensional than the one that you...
Equidimensional?
Yes.
Oh, yes. There is this very degenerate flag variety that Gisland talked about. So that's equidimensional, and it has many reducible components, so they intersect, and so it is singular, and I mean heavily singular. And yeah, so now it's not a classification of smooth quiver Grassmannians is still not clear. I mean, this is the classification of smooth quiver Grassmannian of minimal dimension somehow.
Other questions?
Are there examples? So you said that there are two varieties that are deformation equivalent.
Yes.
Are there examples that they are not isomorphic?
Yes. So the example is, I didn't show you because for time reasons. But in type D, there is an example of two varieties quiver Grassmannian, which is P2 blown up in three generic points, and another one which is P2 blown up in three points which are collinear. And those two varieties are not isomorphic, but they are deformation equivalent. They are diffeomorphic. I mean, you can deform the complex structure, but they are not isomorphic as projective varieties. Yeah, and actually, I mean, of course, I wanted to reprove the Caldero-Chapoton formula. I started with type A, and then I was very happy. Okay, they are isomorphic, and then I found this example. And then I was stuck for some months, and then I found the right notion of deformation equivalent varieties. So that's, yes.
Other questions? No, so let's thank Giovanni again.